It's a real pleasure to welcome you all in for this day-long international symposium titled, and it's a mouthful for before lunch, Algorithms and Actualisation, which are two very long words for me for this time of day, and I will just note that they do have A and A in them. So it's a pleasure that we're able to host it here, and on behalf of the PhD in Architecture Design students here at the A, who brought together colleagues, some tremendous participants who will give keynotes during the day's event and talk about the ways in which, let's call it the current state of play in not just the more narrow and focused topic of computation and architectural design research and culture today, but I think also the topic of machinic design systems of all kinds, hard and soft, that architects and many other researchers are engaging as a way to push architecture forward. I, for many years, had the pleasure of teaching in this school a core seminar in one of the graduate programs called Design as Research, which worked through systematically over two terms, let's call it the mid-20th century legacy of machinic design systems and how they begin to influence architectural culture. And for us, one of the kind of key texts in that modern history, every year was a series of lectures that Herbert Simon delivered in the late 1960s, which are gathered together in a book that he published with MIT called The Sciences of the Artificial. And one of the most interesting things that Simon does, I think, in that series of talks that he gave that year is, which span unbelievably across, like his own interest, a number of different disciplines, from cognitive science to psychology, artificial intelligence, management theory, public administration, and several of the fields that Simon was eventually awarded a Nobel Prize for. In fact, a rare example of someone who was awarded Nobels in two different fields, and he's considered a foundational character in many of those. One of the most interesting things he does in that series of lectures is hold up the figure of the modern architect as emblematic today of what it means as a designer to work in a world of artificial languages and systems. And the point that Simon makes in his talk is that, in fact, all architects have ever done is operate at a level of symbolic language and computation, but with things other than machines. And the history that he writes of architecture is how architects model information, and with that modeling, describe relationships between things that evade appearance or description. And it's a remarkable thing that he doesn't even really pause to comment on. And it was picked up, of course, by a few pioneers in architecture in the 1970s especially, who are part of a legacy that I would argue extends all the way to this day with our guests in the room here at the AA. But what's so interesting is this very unique property that architects have always had to operate at this level of symbol systems. And in that way, and in the argument that Simon makes, operate as if computers, in a machinic sense, in the processing of information that converts it from written descriptions like briefs and graphic pictures of sites into proposals. And the point Simon makes is that we've always, as architects, been operating in that space of information processing. And of course, what has happened over the last half century, the last 40 years or so since Simon's points are made, is that this idea of information processing and of design systems themselves being machinic and processing oriented is, of course, taken on a life of its own in spectacular dimension and depth. And I think if that, for me, is the sort of broader cultural context for this, I think the only other point I wanted to make in today's fantastic kind of statement of the state of play in that field now is that this symposium has been organized by Ali and Elif as part of our still fairly recent at the AA PhD in Architectural Design program, which we are now really still in the very, very early stages of establishing within the school, in which the idea of advanced scholarly work now includes design work itself as a part of 3 or 4 year engagement. And you'll get an opportunity to, of course, see in some of the presentations today the work of our students in that field. And I'll draw these comments to a close here just to say thank you, everybody, for coming in today. I know others are going to be joining us throughout the day and fill up some of the chairs, this being the last Friday of the last week before all of the chaos of next week's final presentation start. But I know a lot of people here are really pleased to have everybody in. Elif Ali, thank you so much for organizing it, and I'll turn it over to the two of you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Britt, for the introduction. We would like to make a small introduction before we get going with the day. So myself, Elif, and Ali, we would like to thank Britt and the PhD committee for their support in helping us put the symposium together. Especially, we would like to thank Simon Sianas, the director of the PhD program, and George Geronimidis and Michael Weinstock, the directors of the AAMTech Master Program, for their support. So as we can see, we have a very exciting day ahead of us, and why we have been interested in this agenda is that there have been lots of discussion lately on the theoretical and practical implications of computation in architecture research, and we believe that the symposium serves as an opportunity to engage in meaningful dialogue on this particular topic. So we have invited 6 PhD in architectural design researchers from different backgrounds to share their research with us, in particular the role of computation in their PhD research. And also we have 3 keynote guests who have contributed significantly to the integration of computation in architectural design research. Our keynote speakers are Xavier De Kestelier, Joint Head of Foster and Partners, SMG, and Director of the Smart Geometry. Mark Burry, Senior Architect for the Sagrada Familia Basilica Foundation and Professor of Urban Futures at the University of Melbourne. And John Fraser, Professor of Evolutionary Design at the EGS. The intention in this topic comes from the observation that the role of computation in architecture research has had a profound impact in terms of empowering us to go into other fields such as mathematics and science, infusing innovative ideas into architecture. As a result, algorithmic design has developed forward to an interdisciplinary domain. And so we found these ideas and as an opportunity to discuss and to share the research, that the ongoing research, and to discuss the future of the research as well.
Now, while techniques and methods which associate computation and design research in novel ways are discussed, the effect of new design paradigms brought about by computation on PhD research will be questioned. Today's symposium will take place over a 3-day session, all-day event. As Brett had said, the symposium will be set up to discuss the current ongoing research incorporating the interdisciplinary domains of biology, mathematics, artificial intelligence, urbanism, and other fields. In addition, the session will debate how such different domains integrate with architectural design by setting up innovative methodologies which employ computation on a multitude of levels. Each session will be composed of 2 PhD researchers who will present their work, followed by a keynote lecture. Each keynote lecture is followed by a small discussion. While today's symposium targets to comprehend the impact of computation in relation to advanced design research, we hope that it serves as a greater contribution to the future of design research and architecture. And with that, we would want to welcome everyone and start the day. Thank you.
Well, good morning, everybody. Thanks very much for coming along. And thank you to Elif and Ali for inviting me to speak today. So I'm going to be talking about my doctoral research, which is predicting building energy performance. And the product of this research is a design tool, which I'll give a demonstration of at the end of this talk. So my research has been is taking place at the Bartlett, just up the road. And I'm being sponsored by the architecture practice AHR, which used to be known as IDIS. And AHR and UCL have been in partnership for a few years now, and they're really interested in this idea of data within the building industry. So starting with data and looking at this graph, which is a representation of all of the world's data storage capability. In 1986, so this is 2 years after I was born, Only around 1% of the world's data was stored digitally. Moving into the early 90s, not really much had changed. It moved up just a little amount. By the year 2000, about a quarter of the world's data was stored digitally. And then after this, it really began to explode. And by 2002, there was a moment in time where half of the world's data was stored by analog means and the other half was stored digitally. And this is what some scholars have called the beginning of the information age that we're all very much accustomed to today. And then since then, it's just continued to explode up. And now there's so much more data and the vast majority of it is stored digitally. So because of this, the last 10 years has seen a lot of research into this idea of big data. And so typically it's people like Tesco and Google and even governments that are using this data to learn more things about the subject. And they're using statistics and machine learning techniques in order to make better decisions. So within the building sector and my area of energy, there's two types of ways that we can collect data. First of all, there's the calculations that we make during design. And finally, there are measurements that we take on buildings once they're actually constructed and in operation. Carbon Buzz is a study which collects data both in terms of design and real performance. And what we found is that the predictions that we make as designers is actually far lower than what buildings actually consume when you measure them in operation. And so this data is taken for schools in the UK. And it's very typical to find around about a 50% gap between what we predict and what buildings actually consume. So I don't have time to go into the reasons for this. There's a lot of research being carried out by AHR. These are some school buildings that we designed, and we go back once they're constructed and we evaluate how they're actually performing. We find things like occupants are there longer than designed for. There are more pupils in the classrooms. The building fabric can perform slightly differently than designed for. To take you through a very brief example of something that I was involved in, about 3 or 4 years ago, I was asked to assess the daylight capability of the London cable car stations. So as you can see, it's mostly glazed around the facade. And so, to no great surprise, I found that the daylight on an overcast day was actually sufficient enough not to require lighting. So once it was constructed, I took a visit along during the day, and I noticed that the daylight was fine, so I was relieved. But I noticed that the lights were on. It's just a very kind of simple example of buildings not performing or being operated in the way that we kind of idealize during design. So if anybody wants to know more about this sort of research, Judith Kempion at AHR and the team at Carbon Buzz, which is now based at UCL, have produced lots of literature in this area. My task was to create a design tool to try and overcome this performance gap. So this was my research aim, which essentially is to create a tool which is more accurate than typically exists today, and also make it user-friendly so it can be used by non-simulation experts like architects. So taking a step back and looking at environmental design, it's very much a balance between different aspects. When you solve one problem, like daylight, you can create another problem, like overheating, for example. So these are known in design as wicked problems. There's no real right or wrong, just better or worse. So in a sense, there's no global optimum that can be reached. So because of this, we as designers have our experience, which is the most important thing perhaps, especially early on in the design process. And we also have design aids that we can use to help us make decisions. So looking at design aids in a bit more detail, they can be categorized into 5 main groups. Simple design guidelines, basic calculations, correlation-based methods, actually physically constructing the buildings and then testing them in real life, and finally building simulation. With regards to energy consumption, building simulation is often said to be the most flexible because of the wicked problems that I spoke about before. The problem with building simulation, though, for architects, is that they tend to reject these tools. This is often because they're very complex, requiring a lot of training. So a lot of the time, this work is outsourced to engineers. Very slow feedback, which is most important at the early stages of design. So it can take quite a lot of time to input the data. The runs can take minutes to hours. And if you're outsourcing the work to an engineer, it can take days or weeks to get a result back. And that's okay later on in the design stages, but early on, perhaps the building is moved forward, the design is moved forward. And they also create discrete solutions, single solutions. And there's a whole host of solutions within the design space that these tools don't pick up. Lawson is an architect and psychologist, and he's claimed that these tools are evaluation tools rather than design tools because of the time that it takes to collect all of the data to put into these tools. And you have to wait until a lot of the decisions are made, and therefore you're just evaluating your design rather than designing with these tools. So Samar Singh is a computer scientist, and he looks at this difference between the physics-based methods and database methods. So he claims that if you can just take a step back and you can learn system behavior through observations. So in the UK, the slides have actually changed because it's a Mac slightly. Display energy certificates are required by law for public buildings over a certain size. And artificial neural networks are one way of predicting global behavior in complex real-world systems. So my methodology was, first of all, to collect data on buildings, energy data and design data. Use this data to train neural networks. And finally, use the neural networks as the basis of a prediction tool. So a couple of years ago, I began collecting data on around about 600 buildings across the UK, and I used schools as a test case. So rather than looking at one or two schools in a great amount of detail, I was looking at many schools in lesser detail. So I was using digital map software and online databases and really anything that I could get my hands on. So some of the data that I collected were activity-based, the number of occupants, whether or not the school was a primary or secondary school, whether the school was naturally ventilated or had some mechanical systems. I'm looking back over digital maps to find out precisely when the schools were actually built. And taking simple geometric measurements, we were able to derive some basic ratios, looking at how exposed the building is, looking at how deep the building is. Because a building with the same internal floor area, if it's constructed differently and configured differently, it actually will perform very differently as well. And finally, things like glazing ratios on various facade orientations by looking at the proportion of glazing on each facade. So taking all of this data, I was then using that to train neural networks, which are a machine learning technique based on the neural network processes that take place within the brain. So a rather morbid example of a neural network in medical science is taking the very basic measurements of a tumor and then being able to predict whether or not this tumor is malignant or benign. So really simple things like shape, texture, area. And I wanted to take that approach and apply it to buildings. So taking very simple measurements, floor area, glazing ratios, and then predicting how healthy the building is in terms of energy consumption. So briefly, the training process for these neural networks were initially to randomize the data, split the data into 10 equal groups, and then for each of the groups, use that as a test data for the neural networks, having 10 neural networks in total. And then for each of these 10 neural networks, I would alter the number of hidden neurons to try and optimize the learning capability of the machine. So these 10 neural networks then finally combine to become a committee machine, so that you're actually taking a kind of joint output rather than any one individual output. So this works by them all receiving the same input data, them all making an individual prediction, and then just averaging that prediction to create my output. So that's a visualization for the two committee machines that I've created for my research. So on the left is heating, and the right is electricity, and in the center, you'll see the center output node, and that is the energy consumption prediction for heating and electricity. So looking at the headlines of my research, we're getting percentage errors of around about 22% for both heating and electricity. It's a little bit apples and pears, but when you compare the performance gap in Carbon Buzz, it was showing that there's around about 50% of a gap, so there's an improvement there. And the post-occupancy evaluations are showing that the activity of the occupants and the building fabric is very unknown, so it's very difficult in terms of energy consumption to get a very precise and small error. And so some of the most important factors that were able to be drawn up through this process. For heating, it was found that surface exposure was the most important input. So the more exposed the building is, the more heat it lets escape, a bit like a radiator. If a building is naturally ventilated, it actually consumes more heating energy. It's letting more air out through cracks in the window and openings. For electricity, it was actually less about the architecture of the building and more about how it's used in terms of pupil density and phase of education. So secondary schools consume a lot more electricity because they've got increased IT loads and they've got more labs than primary schools. And so all of this came together to create a design tool, and this is the user interface. I wanted it to be almost like an app in a sense, meaning that I wanted it to be very simple to use. I wanted someone to be able to pick it up and play with it, not having to read a lot of instructions. There's no real amount of data that has to be typed in. It's sliders and tick boxes, so I constrict the user in terms of what is appropriate to input into the design. Just show you a video demonstration. So this is the building footprint. So it's just a simple drag and drop CAD interface. So you can see there in 5 or 6 seconds, you get an instant result. And then you can edit that geometry. Again, very quickly, just updating the results in real time. So you can see here, when you change between primary schools and secondary schools, electricity takes a huge leap up for secondary schools. And again, this is extended hours, so schools that are used after hours will consume more energy. And the pupil density increases, the energy increases also. So the IT loads are increasing. When you change it between natural ventilation and mechanical ventilation, you see a jump up for electricity to run the mechanical systems, and there's a slight decrease in heating. Changing the number of floors is changing the geometry of the building, obviously, changing the floor area. So I think it's important to say that my research doesn't aim to replace simulation. The interface that I just showed there is aimed to be very quick sanity checks for architects at the very early stages of design. But probably more importantly, it want to further the discussion into this idea of big data in the building industry. My tool doesn't actually use big data because I had to collect the data myself. The idea that in the future, tools like Carbon Buzz will be able to collect data across building design practices and building operators globally. And then this data will be able to be used by machine learning techniques and statistics to actually create better and more accurate predictions. So that's my talk finished. Thanks very much. I'd just like to say that in January next year, I'm going to be testing the software with designers, engineers, architects, building scientists. So if anybody wants to get in touch with me, please do email me, and I'll get back to you and we can speak next year. Thank you.
So, hi everyone, I'm Sina, Mostafavi. First of all, I want to say thanks to Elif and Ali to organize and organize this event and inviting me to this lecture. I'm in a hypervalue research group at TU Delft, and my research topic is informed design to production systems. In this lecture, I'm going to first specify the research framework. I would have two sets of case studies, four in total, and then at the end, there will be a discussion and conclusion. I will try to pass from the first to third case study a bit faster, and then the last case study will be introduced in more detail. The main focus of my research is on design systems, and by design systems I mean specifically computational design methodologies that can be defined at the intersection of design methodology and design technologies. So I'm exploring both at theoretical level and technological level to develop and explore different types of design systems, which I call them informed design systems, with the focus of introducing materiality in computational design system for performance measurement and from design to production. So the question is how a computational design system can be materially informed for multi-perform and measurement and evaluation to establish feedback and feedback forward loops between design models and production systems. So in the case studies, I'm going to define some of these workflows for this main question. And how I'm doing this? Basically through some research-oriented design projects. So it's a research by design project. There would be both hypothesis-driven design case studies and goal-oriented prototypes, which are basically some funded projects for developing some design technologies and design methodologies. So, as I said, there would be four case studies. I'm going to do the first, second, and third faster, and then introduce the last one, which is on robotic 3D printing. So the first case study is concerned with performance-driven design and design information exchange. I started this case study with a goal or hypothesis that in architecture, if we want to have optimized structures, we might not need necessarily to have let's say, discrete or continuous discrete geometry, but rather having a vector-based geometry. So the goal was to translate this finite geometry to infinite or vector-based geometry, applying certain optimization techniques. So for that, I develop a information model, let's say, an algorithm to specify how, for instance, in this case, certain software can be connected to connected to each other. For, in this case, connecting MATLAB to Grasshopper, and the goal was to have multiple, let's say, semi-optimal topologies, but automatically extract the vector-based geometry out of this discrete geometry. For this, the challenge was to find and use the right algorithm. So I found a solution outside of the, let's say, realm of computational design for architecture. So, and it was actually an algorithm based on image processing for skeletonization. So the idea was to automatically extract this vector-based geometry, which is an infinite geometry, out of this finite geometry, and simultaneously apply a certain evaluation for a structural simulation to specify, let's say, the profile section, profile section with different, let's say, dimensions. The second set of design system, which are, again, informed design system with a different approach, I call them complex generative design system, which are basically based on complex systems. So in this case, in these cases, actually, rather than specifying the constraint, like in previous case, we are defining rules. So, and the idea is that the evaluation happens simultaneously while we are generating the geometry. So, as I said, rather than having constraint, we are defining rules, embedded rules in the complex system, to and the evaluation and generation happen simultaneously. Again, I won't go to the details of this, but in the conclusion, I'm going to refer back to this case. The next case study, which is more close to production, is a case study that has a specific goal to produce complex, to design, produce and generate complex geometry that can be cut with robots. So, therefore, this was a goal. And the idea was to come up with a design workflow or a design system that can let us have certain simulation, but at the same time, considering this constraint for, which is a constraint, a fabrication-driven constraint. So, like the first example, which the main challenge was translating this finite geometry to infinite geometry. In this case, the challenge was to translate mesh to NURBS. So I developed a method to be able to let the designer be able to translate this mesh to NURBS, and because at the end the components need to be ruled surfaces, so developable to be able to cut it with robots. So and this is not possible with mesh. So this exchange, or let's say, translating from one mode of geometry to another mode of geometry, is was the focus of this case study. And so the and since the idea was to come up with a design workflow in a way to be able to apply this, let's say, module for a more complex geometry or topology. This itself was considered as a kind of potential and also downside of this design tool, but to be able to apply it in a more complex case, so we were using some cells to be able to sort of use this design tool in a larger scale. And again, all the pieces were ruled surfaces or developable, which later can be produced with robot. The next case study, which is which has a focus of robotic additive manufacturing, is a project that is funded by 3TU and Delft and Delft Robotic Institute and ABB, in which we are trying to develop some workflows and technologies to, at the end, print concrete. So, and in general, for my research, what is important is to work with natural material and not necessarily engineered material, which are fully predictable, and see how by correlating or connecting the design system to production system, how we can predict the behavior of these natural materials and use the production system not only as a means of production, but also as a means of simulation and monitoring the behavior of this natural system. Therefore, I specified four main research components for this case study. One was computational design process, the what we have in digital environment. The second was tooling, what we are going to mount on the head of the robot. And the robotics itself, how we can synchronize the programming of the robot with the information that we are getting from the geometry and also the material information. And the materiality itself, how we can document the properties of the material and introduce this materiality in the design to production system. So for this, I started the project with three sub-projects, let's say. One was light project, marker project, and ceramic clay project. So and I said at the end, the idea is to work with natural materials and be able to combine different methods of fabrication with robots to be able to use natural materials and not necessarily engineering materials. So for the light project, we assume that each light at the end later can represent a different material. And if we specify these light colors in any curve, for instance, in a rhino and grasshopper, we want to print exactly what we have in digital with robot, but not a physical, something between physical and digital, and be able to numerically control the lighting, let's say blinking pattern in this case, and the speed of the robot. So in this case, we are controlling the light with Arduino, which later this Arduino will control an actuator for pushing the material, for extruding the material. So this case later was further developed for extruder. And basically, these are the main components for this setup. So in this case, like previous case that we had one, in the first case that we had one single topology, but different configuration in terms of materiality. For any curves in Rhino, we can have different materials highlighted, let's say, in on the curves, and then print them and control them and synchronize the speed of the robot with the blinking pattern of the light. The next try was to see how we can create some material architecture and how this can be translated, again, not something fully physical, but something between digital and physical. So the idea is to introduce this, let's say, porosity in macro scale. In this case, we are representing it with marker just to show the first try. And later, we started to develop extruder. So what was interesting in this experiment was that, for instance, on the right, you can see the very same geometry, but different speed, different material flow will result in different, let's say, output. So, and to be able to control this, we started to document the material properties, the speed of the robot, and the material flow, and create a kind of information set, and later an information model to include this in the design to production process. And so, as you see, this is the documentation. Later, we developed this. And again, in this case, it's not just about like printing. We are making the part of the this part of this machine with a smaller machine with 3D printing. So the idea is to simulate the behavior of the material, but also study with what kind of material properties we can get, which type of, let's say, output. And again, one single curve or one single geometry can be printed with different resolution. So we are customizing the head of the robot, the head of the nozzle in this case, to see how this change can also result in different outputs. So with this startup experiment, we started a studio. So the idea was to, with this, let's say, framework, work with students and design a pavilion, which I'm going to show and describe the project here. So the idea was to consider the material behavior in the form finding process, also consider that we are going to have a compression only structure. So so we are using some tools to do that. But in this case, as I said, we are trying to have something between digital and physical to also study the potentialities, but also like the constraint or the constraint that the machine has, and also informing the design based on these studies. So in this case, we are making a mock-up based on this idea of material distribution. So to just understand the resolution and how this, how the design can actually tune itself or change or alter itself based on what we can have as production system, or in this case, for the robot. And so these are the very first tries. So the idea was not necessarily just focusing on contour grafting, but also combining different methods of fabrication. For instance, in this case, we are creating a mold which is itself produced by a robot, and printing some part of the let's say topology of the pavilion on top of this mold. So to see how we can have a different approach than contour grafting and use this freedom that the robot can use. Yeah, so this project, as I said, it's a project that at the end we are aiming to paint concrete or in general natural materials with robot and with multiple robots at the end. This is a project that is still going on, and then further results will become probably in future, near future. And to conclude, I'm going to compare the four case studies that I've presented here. So if we consider a kind of design space for each of these case studies, means that we in each of these case studies we have multiple possible alternatives in the beginning of the design process. And through this integrated design production system, or through introducing materiality or performance evaluation routines with different approaches, theoretically, we are expanding the possibilities that are not necessarily possible to, let's say, foresee or predict by just using of parametric models or generating the geometry. So what is interesting, for instance, in the fourth case, is that the machine, through connecting the machine to the process of design exploration, we can simulate some aspects of materiality that are not necessarily possible to simulate and understand. They're not understandable with digital means. And therefore, if you consider the process of topology generation in each of these and evaluation or selection, in each of these cases, you can specify different, let's say, correlation between topology generation and evaluation. In this case, in which we are trying to make a holistic system and embed or through data exchange, integrate the evaluation processes or integrate the evaluation processes inside the parametric system. The evaluation is somehow adjacent or really close to the topology generation. While in this case, which we were considering a fabrication, just a fabrication constraints, these are some presumptions that we consider and introduce them in terms of constraints. And in this case, while we are, since we are developing the production setup alongside with the, process of geometry generation, the evaluation is much more integrated into the generative process. So to conclude, I can say the last example is somehow shifting from the idea of file to factory to factory to file. Means that not only we are able to customize our design products or files that we are producing, but also through customizing the factory that produced this file, we are making a connection between these two separate processes, which is production and system. And in this way, the production setup, as I said, is not just a setup or system for producing or fabricating or something, but also for simulating the behavior of some materials that are not necessarily possible to be engineered, or they are more heterogeneous in their nature. Okay, thank you.
VGA, okay.
Do you have any sound?
I do have sound, yes. That's good. I'll just play it here and play it live. It's only the
end.
It's only the end coming through. Through a bit through the speakers, through the microphones.
That's VGA.
All right. Does that work? All right. Well, thank you very much for inviting me here today to speak at this PhD symposium. I think we had some interesting email conversation beforehand, and I think you guys were kind of wondering, should you get some people from practice in or not on this kind of quite academic session here today. And that's why what I'll actually kind of focus the session on is really about research in practice and how I think I've been working in research. Maybe I haven't. It's maybe up to you guys to kind of decide how much research it is or how much it isn't. So, I'm affiliated with three organizations. I'm a partner at Foster & Partners, which I spend most of my time. I'm also a teaching fellow at the Bartlett down the road, and I'm one of the directors of Smart Geometry. And what I'm really going to do today is talk about these three organizations and how I've hopefully kind of done some interesting work and research in each of these entities and how research actually might be different in each of these places. So research through practice, education, and collaboration. So let me first start at the work being done at Foster & Partners, which is the place where I spend most of my time, and how research is being developed there. Now, over the last more than 10 years, I've been part of this group, which is the Specialist Modeling Group, which is a small group within Foster's, and is horizontally integrated, which means we help out, or we consult internally all the architects, but also the engineers. Now, what I'll do, what I'll start off with is really showing how the research we do is very much practice-based and really comes out of the direct needs of within the office. So also the existence and the founding of this group really happened directly from a direct problematic need. It was kind of the late 90s when the office started to design a few buildings like these here, some sketches from Norman, the Swiss Re and the Sage and Gateshead, which were geometrically quite complex. Now, we've done complex buildings before. We actually done quite a few complex roofs before, like the British Museum down the road, the Reichstag. But now these buildings were actually complex facades and complex building skins than just roofs. So how do we deal with that? So we didn't have directly that skill within the office, so we'd end out and kind of try to find a few people that could help us One of them was Mark Goulthorpe at Decoy, and another one is here in the room, one of the keynote speakers, Mark Burry on the Swiss Re. So that was kind of an interesting time that we started to kind of see what other tools and skills are out there in the world that could help us redesign these buildings. As philosophy partners, we kind of like to always in the past and still like to have our capabilities in-house, with Mark being across the world in Australia. We looked at how can we bring this inside. And so then the office decided to hire Hugh Whitehead, which was actually the founder of the specialist modeling group in the late 90s. And for many years, my boss and actually my mentor, I would like to say. Now, when Hugh actually started, people in the office thought, well, he's going to need like massive computers, really expensive software and all that. But he didn't. He just asked for a simple desktop computer and a box standard version of MicroStation, and off he went. Now, these kind of, in the early days, he was playing, yes, playing, great. In the early days, what Hugh really introduced was parametric design within our practice. So these are some of the early parametric tools that he set up for designing the profile of the Swiss Re. This is what we call like a 2.5D drawing, because you have the section, and you have the planning, the little slider going up and down the section to automatically update your plan. So it's all connected. That kind of way of working works quite well, definitely if you then put it in combination with some solid modeling, that was also kind of standard within MicroStation. And what was really quite successful about it is that the architects and designers were really able to kind of sit next to Hugh or sit next to whoever were doing these drawings and influencing. So it was kind of a really direct relationship between the person putting in all the code or putting in all the parameters for these buildings to be derived, and the designer and the architect, right? So that was actually really interesting. These are some of the drawings of the Sage in Gateshead. And you see how it really derived from a few 2D profiles, actually all the parametric stuff was actually done in 2D and then combined later on with some solid modeling. Now, and let me just play these quickly. And I kind of love kind of the beauty of these drawings as well. So at the end of the day, it was some clever parametrics, but also some little programs in the background, making sure that these 2D profiles were actually kind of talking to each other. And these are one of these, again, early 2000s projects that we worked on. Top left is the Beijing airport. Then there's a in the middle. Can I point to this thing? Yeah. It's kind of the first design for the Kowloon master plan. This is Albion Wharf, and this one as well. And this is a St. Moritz building, the Chisel Futura. So that kind of work resulted in, where am I here? Yeah, there we go. So these are the buildings that were constructed around that time in the early 2000s, and is that kind of we call it like the earliest SMG work, and I think it's quite the distinctive way of working as well that resulted in this architecture. Now the team itself, let me talk a little about the team, was kind of then growing a little bit from a one man team to two to about how many were there, seven. Initially back then the there were quite a few people running parametrics and only one or two doing some scripting. We really saw that change quite quickly, that through educational, through people coming in, almost every member in the team started to script or start to pick up scripting. And that was then really apparent in the next building, there's kind of, which I think made quite a shift within the team. That's when the guy on the left, Brady Peters, picked up scripting and started to work on the Smithsonian project, which is a roof enclosure for Smithsonian Institute. Now, that project was really the first one where we almost didn't use parametric profiles, where we really define the whole roof and all every single piece of geometry just through one script and one piece of code. How is this going to work? Is this going to work? Oh, no. This goes through the wrong screen here now. Let me just do this. Can I put that on the other screen? No. So, here's the code that was written for it. In coding terms, really awful because it's kind of had, it's way, way too long, so it's totally not optimized. But it actually didn't matter in a way because we're not writing the perfect piece of code. We were designing a building. So, this is kind of really quickly how it was all built up. There was one master surface, really simple B-spline surface. A grid that was defined because there was foundations there already for the columns. So the roof shape is also quite defined because of we weren't able to really take on any loads on the original building, so all the loads had to really go to those eight defined columns, and all the drainage had to go through that as well. So that's why the overall shape of the building is kind of derived from. Interestingly enough, like this way of working actually changed quite a few things, because when you work with parametric profiles, it was very really direct to communicate your design. Doing it through hundreds and thousands of lines of code and just the geometry popping out, right, was a very different way of working. So, funny enough, like these sets of drawings, this animation was actually made after the building was already on site. So, we found that, and we're still struggling with that, with actually writing the code directly and actually communicating what you're doing, you almost have to, you know, slow down the code, draw stuff that you sometimes don't need to be drawn, right? But just to communicate your design process. And this kind of runs through all the elements that's getting built up. So there's a bottom, so all the there's a complete twist in all the steel as well, as you see that slightly. So all the beams slightly twist over. All the panels are quadrilateral flat panels, but because of the roof surface, they actually have to pop up. And you, although you don't see that from the inside, from the outside, it does have this kind of scaling effect. Of course, once you've kind of generated that geometry and that set of instructions, we can actually kind of get out different geometries, because not everybody needs the same kind of geometry. You know, if an acoustician for rendering, for structural engineering, they all need different outputs. So through that piece of code, we were able to kind of output that really easily, different representations of it. So that for me was actually quite an important project back then. Now, do some trickery here. Hopefully I can get back to the... So, okay. So, of course, once you have these, in the last project I already kind of referred to it, once you have these ways of exporting different kinds of representations of your geometry, how do you communicate that, right? Well, over the years, we've kind of, what you can, one thing to do is just give a 3D model, right? But over the years, we've actually developed a methodology within Fosters and within SMG, which we called geometry meta statement, which in a way is, what you see here is a very complex staircase for a building being constructed in the city right now. And it is a way to describe your geometry as an instruction set. It really is a bit of an IKEA manual to your geometry. Of course, we could give you the mathematical description of that spiral there, of the spiral staircase. But there is actually so much more involved. You know, this is not just a pure piece of geometry, this is actually a piece of building. So, and you can't really describe this building as just some plans, sections, and so forth. And it's actually already quite difficult to describe it as just giving a 3D model. What you really want to do is give an instruction set how it's really built up. Because in that way, you describe the geometry in much more detail. And it's more also an educational thing. You kind of educate your contractor, your fabricator, or how this thing really fits together. So there's actually only one way to really read this set of drawings. You know, this, so it always gives that one little drawing first, which gives you an instruction set of what drawing to read after which one. And there's also one, the first drawing also has all the parameters in, so there's no dimension in any of these drawings except the first one. So the first one has all the dimensions in, right? And so you could almost see it as this, a drawing set, but also kind of a piece of code. And I'm just gonna flip through. This is about, for that staircase, I think we had about, was it 25 or 30 drawings or something to explain it. And this is the thing being on site right now. Near bank. Now, you saw the kind of the early picture of about seven people heading the being part of the specialist modeling group. We've grown quite a bit since then, and since then we split. Well, we didn't split the group up. We kind of created two streams of it. One is geometry and fabrication, which I'm heading, and then my colleague Irene Gallo. She deals with anything to do with building physics and many simulations and analysis. And underneath we have this kind of design technology catalyst, which is also the kind of the global area where we do our research. Now, although there's two streams, these two streams actually continually work together. This is an image of the National Bank of Kuwait, which is now also under construction. And it's kind of a nice example of a building where almost every team member of SMG had something to do with, because there's very complex geometry going on. We did lots of wind analysis, solar studies, acoustical studies, and optimization for cladding and so forth. So you see, it's really the combination of all these people together that work on one particular project. This is kind of a quick snapshot of the team of, I think, it already changed. I think this is a picture of about, snapshot of about a month ago. And funny enough, if you look at the people and their backgrounds, there are actually quite a few different backgrounds. So the team started with just plain architects. Now we actually brought in some expertise from other industries as well. We have, for example, two aerospace engineers. We have acousticians. A mechanical engineer, bioengineer, computer scientist. But funnily enough, like what I'm always really careful about, that we don't just hire any computer scientist, we don't just hire any aerospace engineer. It always has to be somebody who has really an affinity for design and architecture. So these people are not just technicians, these are people with, you know, who like architecture, who kind of want to engage with architecture as well. So I think that's kind of fundamental to it. Yeah. Even the computer scientist, he actually knows more about architecture than I did because he just built his own house. So these are kind of, there's a kind of an interesting connection there. Also, they're all different backgrounds, but one thing they have in common is computation and digital skills. So it's very easy for the acoustician to talk to the geometry guy and so forth because they all speak code at the end of the day. They're all from all over the world, but this, in the way they speak the same language, they know the same logics. So, and I think it is because of that setup that I think there is a kind of a really interesting and unique platform for innovation and research. So this is how it's split up. So you've got geometry and building physics. That's kind of the big kind of categories we use. There are some subcategories, but these are quite fluent, I would say. So on the left hand side, we have parametric BIM, architecture engineering integration, design to fabrication, geometry modeling. And on the right hand side, we have the thermal comfort, lighting, acoustics, and wind analysis. Although it doesn't mean, you know, these areas are kind of still fluid. You know, some people do two or three of these tasks. So what I thought, I'm more involved, of course, on the geometry and fabrication side. So what I really, I'm just kind of conscious of time as well. What I really do is talk really, really flick almost through some of the latest projects we've done, because what I really want to do is talk a little bit about the research. This is the Crossrail station in Canary Wharf. This is going to be really, really fast. Which is now, these are all the node connections. Almost every single one of them is different. And that is now being finished. Well, the roof is finished, outside of the, but the station itself hasn't been finished yet. Projects like the Quinalia Airport, which is all prefabricated concrete shells, then brought together on site. Quite a bit of direct fabrication happening there, where we work directly with the shipyards in Greece to get the molds created. But we also work on kind of old projects like boats, the yacht project we did. This was quite a good fun one, which was the, not an airport, but it's a spaceport for Richard Branson's Virgin Galactic. This is the library in Masdar, which we finished a couple of years ago. As you see, the projects that we get involved with is normally the ones with the rather complex shapes. That's when they come and knock on our door. And this project that finished just last year, which I was able to visit only a few months ago, which is the Kitech cruise terminal, in the location where the original airport in Hong Kong used to be. We did quite a lot of work on the panelizations there. So that was like the really speedy overview of projects that have just been created, been finished with our help. Then what I really want to talk about is this kind of design technology catalyst. So I think what we often do is look at technology and then evaluate that and see how we can use that within our practice, right? So we're a little the test case of new design technology and construction technology. So for example, things like we're playing a lot around with an Oculus Rift in the last few months. And what we really kind of, we put these things out in design board reviews or with clients quite quickly, and to kind of evaluate that and see how that works for us. One thing we kind of really immediately saw is that anybody over 40 or 50 can actually not use an Xbox controller and have no idea what to do with these things. So what we've been developing now is how can we actually walk in this space, in the virtual space, in a much more natural way, right? How would you walk through a building but not through a game? Because these things are really made for walking through games and moving really fast and in really particular movement. So now we're looking at ways with hand movements or with like looking in certain directions in moving through these virtual spaces. Another thing that we looked at, we know that every architecture school has their own robot now, and there's a kind of a global obsession with them. And this is kind of a nice image from Stuttgart, I think. And I was wondering myself, so what, okay, I get all these students in that know how to program robots, what am I gonna do with these guys, right? So I asked myself the question, so what would we use a robot for? Right, I think it would be probably something quite different that an architecture school would use it for. So I did the simple thing, I asked people. So I went to our office and I asked all our support departments, anything from our cameraman to our material research center, to our product design team, to anybody basically does anything. And also, what would you do with a tool that can automatically and accurately place a point or a position in space and time, digitally controlled, right? Because that's basically what it is, right? And it was interesting kind of comments I got and people asking for very, very old things. You know, our cameraman wanted to have a time lapse that moved. He wanted to take a picture of a space and by each time move a every minute or something, like a fraction of a millimeter over a day. And of course you can do that. Then I went to our environmental guys and they said, oh, what we would kind of be interesting is have a heliodome, but we don't have the, you know, the space and time to kind of make an actual heliodome, where we want to visualize how the sun goes over our model. So you can do it all digitally, of course, quite easily, but to interact with clients and to really kind of in a design process, it might be actually quite good to do it physically, you know. We have a kind of a strong tendency to do stuff physically. We have loads and loads of models in the office. There's a strong emphasis on model making as well. So that might have been kind of a great way to do it. So we kind of tested that out. We asked Kuka for a robot, sorry. and no OBB. This is a Kuka. That's a Kuka robot, this one. To rent as a robot for a few months, so we're playing around with it. And then at that point as well, we had our product design team was designing this table, which is made out of metal sheet, and then has some incisions in, and then by just pulling that, they were able to create this coffee table. A bit like when you have metal fences are created like that as well. You have like slits in them and then you pull them out and you actually get these kind of structures. And they asked us actually for a digital model. So like, can you make us a digital model? Because we can't actually make it digitally, but we can make it physically. You know, they had these little brass, little models. These are like tiny things. See, we can do it, but we don't know how to digitally model that. And so it was actually quite tricky because it's all about deformations, plastic deformations of the metal. So we thought, well, we have our robot, then why don't we just kind of do a scale? Oh, that didn't work. Hang on. So we said, well, we'll do it on a 1-3 scale. So we made a little jig, had some water jet cut these steel plates. And what we were able to do by just changing the incisions and the cut profile, we were able to change each time that profile of that table. As you see there, this is one example. Which we wouldn't be able to do in any other way. So digitally would have been quite tricky to do, but we found like a physical way to do it. And these are some of the images of the table now, which is, I think you can buy the table now even. So it's a Multani table. There you go. Of course, the real fabrication process was actually completely different. They wouldn't have had a normal robot to do this. They had some big press or something like that had to do it. So it was just a kind of a prototyping fabrication methodology, let's say. So a lot of things really happen out of just pragmatic and direct needs in the office. Another nice example, classic example, is when we started in 3D printing. This is the Yacht Plus project that we worked on, it's kind of mid-2000s, which was a series of yachts, 43-meter long yachts. We built four of them. And we've got this strong emphasis of always making digital and physical models. And the problem was with the yacht is we were really accurately digital, but like physically it really didn't work out because we want to make them really fast and we didn't have any tool to do this. So this was around 2003 or 4, I think. So we thought, well, you know, I saw a couple of 3D printers. I think it was at an Acadia or a Smart Geometry conference. I thought, let's try this out. Directly on a project. We're not going to research, we're going to like go for it and see what happens. What happens is that we saw it as a sketch tool. You know, this is my desk at that time. We didn't really see the models as kind of a finished object. We really saw it as a three-dimensional sketch, right? And that's how it actually stayed now. These things are really almost throwaway sketches, but just in 3D. Of course, you make the nice model as well if you want to. I just want to show this one that we, you know, the finished product. And this is kind of a nice example of how we kind of implement technology. It's been tested out in our group first, and this is the project that we're working on at the time. And then very quickly, I think it only took like about 3 months before almost every single project within the office was using 3D printing technology. And that's about, you know, a bit over than 10 years ago. These are some of the kind of early tests we did to kind of see if we could break the machine. Or the process. And we kind of went on and bought like a whole bunch of these. And interestingly enough, like early on, you really want to kind of, as an architect, you're still making models, you're not making the real thing. And in rapid prototyping and additive manufacturing, you know, we're really slow. You know, there's a few industries out there that have been doing this for years, for 20 years. And they made the move from making the model, which is a model or a representational thing, to the actual part. You know, Formula One is a nice example of that. There are now actually, for example, air intakes for Formula One cars, they are printed in SLS plastic, and they actually change for each track. So the geometry of them, they actually change for each track. So and they're actually racing with it as well. I'm just a bit wary of time. So we were really interested in kind of, can we push this technology to a way to not just print models, but print actual buildings or building components. And this was around, I think around the same time, 2004, 2005 or something like that, we were invited by Loughborough University to become part of a consortium to design the first concrete printer. Right. And I'm just showing this project now because just about a couple of weeks ago, we just picked up this research project again, now with industry involvement. So we have ABB involved, we have Skanska involved, and now we're really going to try to commercialize this process. But the images you see here is really about the really early ones. This is about 2009 or something like that, where we had this first concrete printer. And learning from it in a way, well, we were interested in it not actually, you know, developing the machine as such, but really understanding why this, how this might change how we design. One of the first things we figured out is that the beads that you print out are really, really visible, right? And they're actually part of the design. So we then started to not just design a solid model, but redesign the tool part. So we had some parametric tools out there and scripts that really didn't just already had the manufacturing technology in it while you were designing with it. So I wasn't designing as just a solid and then hatching it within or filling in with tool parts. No, the tool parts were part of your design tool immediately. So this was this kind of a little prototype mock-up wall that we did and some double curved panels. But that, so that project is a few years old now, but we now restarted that and tried to see if we can go from a real university-based project where, you know, the concrete was mixed by the PhD students to now having industry involved, having Skanska involved, having Buckens, which is a prefabrication company in the UK, and do it within an industrial area instead of just at a university. I know I'm running a bit out of time here. So one of the things I was interested in is looking at how design changes, right, with 3D printing, how we can need to rethink and almost kind of throw away what we already know. And so I wanted to do that with students. And I, as I say, I was running a studio at the GED at the Bartlett a couple of years ago, and I wanted to test it out. But of course, you can't start printing really big parts in buildings and all that, functional parts. So what I really want to do is make it on something else, make it on a bike. A bike, I think, is kind of an architectural piece because it has a structure and it has all these kind of bits added to it. A bit like buildings, normally have structures and facades and all sorts of systems added to it to make this kind of one functional building. A bike is kind of the same thing. So I asked the students, can you just now take a part of this bike, doesn't matter any part, could be, for example, the handlebars, and rethink that as a 3D printed part, you know. A normal handlebar is made out of tubular steel that has certain diameters that you can bend, limitations in that. It's hard, so you put some tape around it, so it's soft, it has the brakes, which is in a certain location. So it's quite an architectural piece, but what would you do if you made in one material? And not just design it, but really go and print it and try to use it as well. So this was kind of a handlebar that has the gear shifters in your grips, has brakes almost everywhere, you can touch it anyway and it breaks. Light is not a light, the whole thing lights up, for example, because there's lights inside. There's some structure optimized seating out of made of one material, but where the material changes, it actually kind of performs differently. Or there is a shock absorption system fork that just by the geometry is able to kind of take up absorption. Or rethink completely what a tire is. And these are kind of springy elements, which is basically a tire that you can't burst, you can't go flat. And actually try it out, you know, kind of worked, let's say that. Like a couple of meters. So, I'm a bit aware of time now, 12 minutes. What I'll do is I'm gonna skip over this part. Yeah, I was gonna talk about smart geometry, but let me just skip over that. I'm gonna talk about it really quickly, which is an organization I've been involved over the last 10 years, and Marcus, for example, also been involved. I think you've been to every single one, which really tried to see how we could do research in a kind of a slightly different way. And it's an organization that's really kind of based within academia and practice and industry. So it actually falls in between. It's a place where you don't need to submit papers that get peer reviewed, you need to submit a workshop that get peer reviewed. So it's a slightly different process. But what I'm gonna do is not talk about it now. I'm gonna talk about one more project. I'm gonna flip through these. I'm gonna finish with this. So talk about research again. This is actually your first research project that, well, this is actually our second biggest research project we did. The first one was with Loughborough. This one was for the European Space Agency. And it was quite interesting because we worked together with a couple of companies, a space engineering company called Alta, D-Shape, which is a company that does large-scale 3D printing in Italy, and the Scuola Superiore di Sant'Anna from Pisa, mainly their robotics department. So what was a brief? We had a very simple brief. ESA was figuring out, they wanted to know how could you do 3D printing building blocks using lunar soil. So that was the main brief. They wanted to see, could you use soil regolith on the moon and create constructions with that, right? We were involved because they actually didn't really know what they're going to construct with it. They thought it was kind of a very cool idea, but what we looked at was mainly to use as shielding, right? So people we worked with, like I said, Alta, which is a space engineering company in Italy, they mainly do propulsion systems for satellites. But what they're really good at is also they have really large vacuum chambers, which we used extensively in the project. There's D-Shape, with Enrico Dini's large-scale printing machine. So how do you start a project like this? Right? How do you start designing something on the moon, a moon base with regolith? So last time we went, it's actually quite a while back, and you can only see this as an extended camping trip, because we didn't really stay there for too long. I think it was the maximum the Apollo 17 stayed for a few days, I think, and that was it. So the architecture of being there, this is, you have to see this as the caravan, but what will be the long-term solution be, right? And looking at the research being done in space and lunar habitation, they really fell into two categories. There was this one category, which was, I call it, the more the artist impression. There's quite a few projects done that really looked at it in a quite fluffy way, you know. I don't think the astronaut would have an iPad in his hand or something like that. So, you know, they were very artistic and very inaccurate. And on the other hand, there's loads of books out there with really, sometimes rather boring white papers explaining one particular part of a lunar habitation. And it can be absolutely tiny, how a hatch closes or something like that. It's absolutely ridiculous. Very, very tiny. So what we want to do is kind of have this kind of overall, so go quite technical, but still have an overall vision of it, what it could be. So we wanted to place ourselves right in the middle of those two extremes. So what do you do first? Well, we want to look at existing technology. What is out there? What kind of long-term space habitation is out there? Well, one of the first ones you can think of is, of course, the International Space Station that is now orbiting around us for many, many years. And but also, like, this one, which doesn't exist anymore, is Mir. Space Station was actually the first long-term space habitation module. And if you look at these, they all look quite the same. What they look at is they're just a bunch of kind of cylindrical elements all fit together, right? You can see that here. This is the ESA's Columbus module is their lab up there. It has a very simple reason why they all look like that. Because that's kind of the maximum space that you get in a rocket, right? In an Ariane 5. So that's the maximum stuff you get up there. At one time. But then, of course, the space is inside, that's what it looks like. So you basically live in a bunch of technical corridors. So the other limiting thing is, of course, weight. So to bring anything up into orbit or anything to the lunar surface is going to cost you I think for a kilogram to lunar surface, it's going to cost you about £200,000. And you know, you have a lot of kilos need to bring up there. So there's a huge cost involved. So we start to think, like, how can we get something that is lighter and is not restricted to these kind of cylindrical elements? So we start to look at, well, this is just a kind of an image from an art piece from Thomas Saracino, looking at inflatables. Could we use inflatables in space? Is that a way forward? Because you can compact them so the space is smaller, you can create more interesting spaces, and they are light. Of course, all great ideas, you're never the first. NASA has been working on inflatable space modules for quite some time now, and they're actually licensing that technology out to a company called Bigelow, and they are looking at creating the first space station, commercial space station, made out of inflatable elements. And it's not that crazy because they already have the Genesis module up there, which is an inflatable satellite. So there are actually some inflatables are already hovering above us. So looking at these things, looking at existing technology, looking at inflatables, we came up with this kind of main concept here, which is we started off with these standard cylindrical elements, which you see here, right? Which could have all the life support and all the technical equipment in. And then out of that element, we could actually create an inflatable, which is the blue here, pressurized volume, which could in a way be all this, could be probably stored within one of these modules. So you could imagine that you bring this, inflate this, and then build it up, right? And around it, you see this, oh my God, this is not going, I want it to go. Around it, we have this shell structure, which you see here in the red in the section. Now, why do we have that? Well, the moon is actually an extremely harsh environment. First of all, there's a vacuum, there's no atmosphere. There is meteorites, because there's no atmosphere, meteorites will impact. There's huge temperature differences, and there's gamma radiation. So let's look at all these kind of factors and how those really define the final design of this lunar base. So first thing, radiation. There's two radiations that you need to protect yourself from. There's a cosmic radiation and a solar radiation. But actually the solar radiation is the one that is much more dangerous and much more higher. So much more higher gamma radiation. So how are we going to protect us from the sun? Is the main question. If you want to protect yourself from the sun, you need to know where the sun is. You need to know where the sun is, you need to know where you're going to be on the moon. So look at two spots. Imagine that you're on the equator of the moon, which is the one spot over there, which is around that area where a lot of the Apollo missions went. If you stand there and the sun will come up, and it will take about 14 days for the sun to rise and then go back under, and then you have 14 days pitch black night. So not the best way to be. What you want to have is much more sunlight, especially if you're going to look at using solar cells to create energy. So we looked at another location, which is the South Pole of the moon. And if you would be at the South Pole, what you would see is potentially you would have the sun on the horizon and it would go around you over 360 degrees over 28 days. And we actually looked at a site where the moon base could be. This is a little analysis of an area around the South Pole, which is called the Shackleton Crater. This model has, that's about a 50 by 50 kilometer square, and the crater there is about 4 kilometers deep. The red zones is where you have eternal sunlight. The blue zones is where you have eternal darkness, which is also the area where they think there might be water. So it's kind of an interesting location to be. Meteorite impact. No atmosphere, which means meteorites don't burn up in the atmosphere, so they will do impact on your structure. Most of these are not massive balls. These are actually quite micrometeorites. The reason why you still need to protect yourself from that is, well, the speed they arrive at the lunar surface. Think about a bullet. A bullet roughly goes about a kilometer a second. A meteorite hitting the moon surface will go at about 18 kilometers a second. So, you know, it is going to hurt. So another parameter that you need to be careful for is extreme temperatures. Now, we always thought we developed projects in really extreme temperatures. You know, this is our Mazda development, getting up to 50 degrees. This is a project we did in Kazakhstan, up to minus 35. But then we go to the moon, and you have more than 250 degree difference. So what you need to do is protect yourself for that as well. So let's kind of recap and have all these kind of parameters now defined this, our moon base, or the structure of it, or the overall topology. Start off with this inflatable. We want them to create, between the inflatable and the shell structure, the regolith structure, about a zone of about 30 centimeters that actually don't touch each other, at least. Also, a vacuum would create a very good insulator. We looked at, because we were thinking of course, printing with the regolith, 3D printing with regolith, we wanted to stick with catenary arcs. So we only have pressure in the system, no tension. Knowing that the sun was going to go around us only on the horizon, we only had to protect ourselves for gamma radiation in kind of in a horizontal way. So we kind of did an offset of the structure horizontally. Our space engineering firm, Alta, then did some tests, and they kind of suggested we should have about 1.5 meters thickness to protect ourselves against the gamma radiation. We need about 800 to protect ourselves from the micrometeorites. And there's a few other rules involved that then defined that actual shell structure. So how thick it was and what exact shape it would be. And you kind of see that shell structure. Now, to make it, as I kind of mentioned a couple of times before, ESA was interested in using local materials, which we often do in other projects as well. So there is regolith, which is moon dust, right? Regolith is moon dust. There's lots of it. There's about, I think, anything from 20 centimeters up to, I think it's 2 meters or something, regolith all over the moon surface that you can use. But the idea was that we basically scoop up, this is kind of my own design of what a moon robot would be. It took me about an afternoon, so that wasn't actually technically worked out yet. But the idea was that it is not a big printer. You're not going to bring a big printer to the room. What are you going to do to the moon? You're going to bring smaller elements that print a bigger thing. There's little rovers that could up scoop up moon regolith and then deposit it and then bind it together with the binder, which is at that point in the research was based on magnesium oxide, and we still need a fluid as well. And I'll show you how we kind of went around that. So then going through the construction process, you bring in this kind of elements, the and then you have the inflatable coming out. Now, this is actually a different inflatable from the one I showed first. This is really a scaffolding. So the first one, the blue one I showed, that is actually a pressurized volume for the astronauts to live in. This one works a little bit more like a kite surfing kite, where you have these kind of bladders, which are under high pressure, and in between you have thin fabric. So you see these kind of bladders, these structural beams, and that fabric in between. That gives you a base or a scaffolding to start printing around. Now, of course, what we wanted to do was minimize the amount of binder we were going to use. So what we looked at was thinking, well, you know, we have the outer and the inner shell, there's going to be regolith powder in between. How can we minimize but still create a kind of a good structure? Started looking at these things because you're kind of, you're an architect and you think of space frame structures and have your education and all that, because you kind of learned about these things. But really what you really need to do is with 3D printing, you can print anything. So we start to look at more natural structures. And quite a bit of research went into this, which I'm not going to go into completely, but we looked at we ended up with this kind of cellular structures, foam structures, closed wall foam structures, which reason for that is that each time you print them, every single layer, you still have actually kind of a stable structure to work on. So the intermediate structures still work, you know, to get your robots to go on and develop their the next layer. Also for impact, for meteorite impact, each time a meteor could hit it, it would hit a solid bit of regolith and then a loose bit of regolith, so you dissipate the energy much better. So this was printed at Enrico Dini's facilities in Italy. You see the wall structure is much thicker because we had to calculate it for Earth gravity, not Moon gravity, which is about a sixth of the Earth gravity. What we really wanted to, instead of just testing this in a normal environment, we wanted to test in a vacuum. You know, did this thing actually really work in a vacuum? So we used Alta's vacuum chambers and we made the world's simplest 3D printer, which it prints just one dot, one voxel, basically. So this is our printing setup, a bit of regolith. And instead of dropping the drops on top of the regolith, so the binder on top of the regolith, what we did, we had to inject it inside at about 2 centimeters depth, because otherwise the vacuum, the fluid would just evaporate immediately. So we need to check, does the reaction, the chemical reaction happen before the fluid actually evaporates? And this, I think, is the world's first 3D print in a vacuum. We were really excited about this little sphere, I must say. We have quite a bit of kind of, we use our engineers in-house as well to kind of start calculating this dome. Of course, as usual, they kind of simplify these things as just a normal shell structure. So we then start to do some finite element tests. To really understand how the cell structure would work, what the right cell size would be, what a wall thickness would be ideal, and so forth. And what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna finish off now with playing this video. I'm just gonna work. Can you guys hear this or not? Certainly not. Can you make this louder?
Hollow closed cylinder structure. Under a microscope, it would look very similar to the structure inside a bird's bone. Like bone, it is light and incredibly strong at the same time. When the lunar base is complete, it can house four people. Inside the dome, they're protected from solar radiation, meteorites, gamma radiation, and high temperature fluctuations. The original capsule functions as an airlock and technical support module. The skylights draw daylight into the living and workspaces, which are sheltered within a pressurized enclosure. This method is a pioneering advance in space age construction. At Foster and Partners, we're used to designing for some of the world's most extreme climates. We often use materials found locally to create sustainable buildings on Earth. While the moon is an exciting new territory for architecture, the value of this logic endures.
That was it. Thank you. Mics.
Mic'd up. Well, it was a very interesting morning. And I think just going to your talk straight away, Xavier?
I don't mind any pronunciation. What's the Spanish one I quite like. It's my mom would say Xavier.
Xavier. I'm just trying to think how many people, other than yourself, can actually come to an event like this and put a perspective that's as much from the research and practice, research from a university, and then also a research group, which I think we could call smart geometry. Mm. Now, I've got a diagram which I've shown for years, which is three circles intersecting. And I argue that's the sweet spot in the middle is getting architectural practice, research centres, including government bodies, and universities being able to find that spot. And I say it's very difficult because you effectively need clients who aren't in a hurry because experimentation needs a bit of indulgence. I argue that you need researchers, that's architects, who are happy to put a lot more time onto their career development than they would otherwise, instead of getting straight into business. And you need practices who are happy to share their IP. Mm. So you seem to found those ingredients. I'm just wondering what I've missed.
What do you mean, what you've missed?
Well, and then you need governments that will put funding into it. Well, and the question I have is, why isn't every... My personal circumstances, the Sagrada Familia in Barcelona is the first enterprise I know that said, rather than consult with architects, with universities, they would form legal contracts with them so that it was a co-development of research. So I've been waiting all my professional life to see that happen more widespread. It hasn't hasn't happened very widely, but Foster's obviously are doing it.
Well, I think one of the things is because of the size of the practice. If you're certain that I think we're now again 1,300 or something. So once you're that size, you can actually afford. It's simple economics almost. You could afford to have a set of people doing this kind of work. I think. And it just becomes, you know, if you're a certain size, we have two photographers in the house, for example, as well, and a cameraman. So once you kind of hit that critical point, you can start to create a group like that. And that's one thing. But also, I think it has to be from the top down as well. There has to be a belief that a group like this will help the business and does really push it forward. And that happens, of course. So, you know, Norman and the senior execs, they really believe that our team can really keep on pushing our practice in certain directions that we wouldn't go otherwise if a team like this wouldn't exist. So I think that's kind of two things that need to exist within the company itself. And then I think you talk about that sweet spot, you really have to find those sweet spots. You know, the project with ESA was just happens in a very particular way because person at ESA knew Enrico Dini, Enrico knew me, and then we suddenly thought, well, this is kind of an interesting project to work on, and we found the time to do it within the company as well. But also the research project we do is only kind of a small percentage of what we do. You know, a project like this took us a few months with a few people. The slides I went through really quickly is all the project work. That still takes up most of our time, of course. But it is, you know, trying really hard to find that sweet spot, I think.
So universities have been defined as public spaces, so for exchange of ideas, sharing. Business isn't. So there must be some kind of innate tension.
There was always that tension. And I think one of the things I try to, at universities and academic institutions, what you do is really push out your knowledge really quickly and share it as soon as you can, right? What we always do, I think I have this idea, you know, once a building is built, I'm more than happy to share it because our end goal was this building. It wasn't always the research behind it. So, we do push these things out, but just a bit later, I think. So, you know, if I would show projects here, I would actually just show projects that are constructed and are out there. I'm not going to probably show the stuff that we're doing right now. You know, it just takes a bit longer, I think, for us to share things.
So, whereas when in the academic environment and conference circuits, we share dirty laundry quite early in the hope that we can pick up from each other.
Yeah.
Does that mean that in business or practice, you risk not actually having, you know, you're forced actually to try and have everything inside, in-house, because you can't afford to go out? Or is there a way to...
I think the reason why we have a lot of stuff in-house is just speed. And I think it was the first talk that talked about having, you know, working with engineers, and it will take weeks or months to get something back. The reason why we start to have everything in-house is pure speed. So, you know, we don't need to wait for some wind analysis to be done by one of our consultants. We can just do it in-house really quickly and really as a design driver. It's not a verification anymore. It's really as a design driver. So that's really the reason why we've done it. It wasn't really thinking of that we don't need to share anything. It was really done because we'd be faster.
Expedient.
Yeah.
So your practice has changed. Do you see this becoming more widespread? For instance, do you feel that practices will need to scale up in order to be able to do this? Mm. Because presumably, if you have got the right scale to carry all the skills in-house, you're able to produce the product quicker.
Mm-hmm.
That must be a commercial advantage compared to a smaller practice that still has to rely on the relationships with external consultants.
I assume so. I think that kind of comes with it. That if we can do that, you know, we're able to show that we can work at a faster speed. But I think, you know, as a smaller practice, there are so many you know, networks out there of people working together, or, you know, organizations like Smart Geometry that are involved in that, where people can actually, for a short time, have the freedom to kind of share and collaborate. And I think it's always, you know, I was at a conference a few years back, and it was at MIT, and there were lots of people from like Facebook and Google and all that, and there was a question about IP and protecting everything, and one of the things that came out was really being faster and the first, I think, and better. Mm-hmm. So I always kind of been trying to do that, just be there quicker and be there better than trying to protect everything. So
when you showed Swiss Re and the Sage, and implicated me in that adventure, that was 15 years ago, and the story is that I was making my contribution from 20,000 kilometers away, and I couldn't understand what the problem was, because we did a good job, I think, and it was what was required. It was on time and on budget, but just remote. And the whole point of Decoy, Mark Goulthorpe's practice, was around assembling the expertise, no matter where it was, and taking advantage of you know, the internet, to, which means the whole co-location argument would appear to be increasingly redundant. My own experience is that we now work with high-definition video conferencing. That's extraordinary. There's no latency. You can do a sketch on the table. You don't have to hold it up to the camera. It's perfectly clear what's happening. Mm. But in those 15 years, my own experience is that you do need to be co-located to have sensible design conversation. There's something that happens around the table that just doesn't seem to happen.
No.
Is that...
I totally agree. So our team is located in the main office, in the main space of Foster's. My team is quite large now, but they're really packed on top of each other at the moment. But I think it's absolutely crucial that they all sit together and that we're all in a central location, right? Because everybody is very digital. Everybody kind of loses themselves within their screen and their coding and kind of more. And I think it becomes even more important that people are sitting next to each other. And my role sometimes is to really get these people to talk to each other, to communicate, or even like who sits next to who is something I really think about in the office. You know, it's really simple like that. And then the other thing I've done is I moved everybody on laptops, because not everybody works on desktops in the office. I moved everybody on laptops, less powerful machines, but what they can do, they can just, again, go and sit for an hour, a day, for 3 months with the team, with the architectural team, which we consult. I think that's really important, that they come back and forth and can work anywhere. But that co-location, I think, is super important, because, you know, I think about 90% of our staff is based in London. So most of the design work gets done in London. And that's also because all our support teams are there. You know, our visualization team, our model shop, SMG. So all these teams are there. So I think co-location, we still find it is really, really important.
Before I move on to an open discussion up, have there been any shifts in culture? I can imagine a high-flying group like Smart, the specialist modeling group, could be seen as the kind of flyboys and girls, a little bit outside the office, the real work of the office.
Yeah.
Or are you seen as crucial? Or is there a range of opinions?
Well, it depends who you know. People that work with us within the office, they really see the advantage of how we... I think sometimes people don't quite understand what we do. We actually have quite... we have to keep on communicating what we really do. Because people say, do you make 3D models? Well, yes, we do. But, you know, we're not just going to make everybody's 3D models for the office. Of course not. So we kind of, you know... see yourself as a group when it's digital, when it's difficult, you probably come to us. You know, we also start to consult the engineers now as well within the office. So we see ourselves having different clients as well. Like, for example, the product design guys, which we haven't worked for years and suddenly needed our help. So we might, you know, we kind of fluctuate between very different areas within the office.
I wonder if there's questions for Xavier. maybe from Greig and Sina, who've working in that lonely space of the PhD candidate, and you've got maybe you should come in closer. You might have questions, I think, because this I think is an extraordinary opportunity to have a very full frontal expose of what a practice can be like in terms of supporting research. Yep, inviting questions.
So, your question again.
Do you have questions? I've suggested you both come in is that there was a whiff of the. I felt it was clear that you were working from the university side of the equation, but both your aspirations are very much within the sort of work that Xavier has been showing us. So I wondered if you had some observations or some thoughts.
The point is in the school, well, we have some of the similar challenges, I would say, we have in practice, for instance. Well, first, the good side of it is that we can work with the students and then develop these, let's say, computational design methodologies and test them in academia. So that's a good side of it. But at the same time, when it comes to funded projects, it's really hard to enter the industry and then somehow persuade the industry that these things can be applicable. And then the point is, for instance, when we are in Europe, when we are applying for funded projects, they usually ask for TRL, technology readiness level of like 4 to 6, which actually for early stage of any research cannot happen. So maybe when you were talking about top-down controls, this should change somehow. And then maybe if practice come closer to the, let's say, education and academia, they can try to deliver sort of technology and application that are close to the TRL of 4 to 6, which is something between ready and idea. These are the main challenges that we are facing, actually. Or you want to react on this and see how? I mean, how do you see how we can define a better, let's say, relation between academia and practice?
Well, I think they have to kind of push each other on. I think a nice example is what we did with the concrete printing with Loughborough is, what we wanted to do is really start printing stuff really quickly. You know, we want to, when is the machine ready? When can we start produce something? When we have a look at something, test it, look at it. And from Loughborough, they were their engineering school. They weren't actually architects. They were actually more than happy to, for the whole 4 years, maybe print small samples. And actually do some material testing on, and really understand the process, and really control everything. And we were like, no, let's go and print something really quick. Let's try it out. So we had these kind of, they want to know we do it slower. We're going to write a paper about every kind of step we do, so we kind of document everything really, really properly. And maybe in the end we might be able to print something, right? And I think these are the two forces of academia and practice, kind of, you know, working against or with each other actually. And I think with technology ready level. I think academics might be pushed a little bit sometimes to kind of get it ready quicker or get something out quicker. And, practice sometimes needs to understand that some things need to go a little bit slower and a bit more, thorough, you know. So I think we can probably learn from each other and actually push each other on as well.
And at the same time in, academia, things should also change. As you're saying, well, these kind of experimental design and experimental processes cannot necessarily then end up with some later technology to be used. So it might take a while. But when you are producing, for instance, what we were doing with this 3D ceramic printing, more or less we are getting at the end some good resolution. And then, for instance, from another groups, people are approaching us, for instance, to create a kind of fast mode for casting non-standard glass, right? So when people see these things, they start to believe that, okay, things might happen. While at the end, academia does not, most of the university does not support these kind of explorations.
Well, I mean, a lot of academia can't support these explorations because the reason they're in academia is because they're not in practice. And that's quite a loaded statement. But there are quite a few people who really have no idea what's going on and what will be going on, yet they sit in academies around the world teaching architecture as they understand it, which is as it was. So that's one tension that we've never fully resolved. There's no refresh requirement where people are meant to be up to date. And then you've got other things which are companies are actually doing their own research. What can they do with their materials that have never been done before, and how can they attract others to use them? For instance, a new technology for, well, I know one that I've had peripheral involvement is curved glass that's laminated, which is a very hard thing to do technically. Well, when they've achieved it, they then look for people to use it. The chances are they're going to go to big practices that do exciting architecture rather than go to schools of architecture, which may not even have anybody receptive. So I think the PhD as a program is one of the best ways to form a link between those three things that I described at the beginning.
Yeah. A quick question, just to follow on from that, about research and practice. It's clear from Xavier's presentation, which is great, that it worked within Foster to have this internal research group. But it's remarkable how few architecture practices actually have their own research teams. I'm just wondering what your advice would be to a small to medium-sized architecture practice who's interested in research in-house but is worried about expense.
Comment on that.
It's a boobie.
Woke me up.
I think the comments were very interesting. I mean, indeed, I was amazed by how Fosters have created their research team and the branching off and the integration of different disciplines and whatever not. And it's true, as you said. If you are as big as Foster, you can afford it, and other companies cannot. And we had a similar experience. I'm a mechanical engineer by training. We had a big project on ropes for mining and towing and whatever not. And the only way to address this problem, how do you get the small companies to benefit, was to create what you may call a club kind of culture, where there was the equivalent of your own research team, but it was shared out between different people. Of course, it had to be open, and I think the openness of the process is a very important one. If you start putting too early legal requirements, IP, whatever not, nothing is going to happen. I mean, except keeping the lawyers happy forever. So there are mechanisms, okay, and this one worked for 20 years very, very effectively, and there were players from various small companies up to very big players as well. Because there was a common lack of knowledge in particular areas, and they wanted to try to get the answers to some of these problems. So it was a research-based, but with sort of interests pulling it in common directions. I'd just like to make a passing comment about this assumption that somehow industry is ahead of academia. That might be true in the case of Foster's. However, overall, I think it has to be said that particularly the architectural profession and the whole construction industry has been lagging massively behind the advanced research in academia for the last 40 years. And I got asked a question the other night about, mustn't it be very frustrating to see all kinds of other industries and other disciplines, from law through to finance, through to even Formula One motor racing, taking up techniques which have been developed primarily for design 30, 40 years ago, and to find that these industries were taking them up, but architecture still wasn't. And so I think we must be careful not to generalize from the experience of Foster's with its capability to stay at the cutting edge and look at what is in fact a very sleepy profession and a very, very backward industry overall.
So Foster's is the exception that proves the rule?
No, I don't think it proves the rule at all. I think there are a number of companies that have that capability. And I'm just warning against the generalization that somehow it's academia that's dragging its heels behind industry. I think your point, Mark, about an awful lot of architecture being taught in schools as it was is absolutely true. But those aren't necessarily the people who are doing the research. And so even inside academia, there is a disconnect sometimes between the studio staff and the researchers, and sometimes an actual hostility. So I think we've got very big problems in the industry, and it could be true that the sort of Foster's model is the only one that's going to work. But frankly, I doubt it. It obviously is working, and that's excellent. But I don't think we can necessarily generalize from it, particularly to do the problem of the scale. Smaller practices has just been mentioned. So I think there are other problems here which are not helped by implying that somehow industry is ahead in general of the researchers. I don't think it's true.
Yeah, what I was really meaning, which I didn't express myself well enough, was that the experimental within the schools is not taken up by industry. Not that it doesn't exist, but I think the critical mass of many schools is such that they don't push the exciting, groundbreaking work that is happening is not necessarily pushed by the school in a way that industries can pick it up.
Okay, well, rather than hog this now, why don't you ask me that again about 6 o'clock whenever we got to?
Fair enough.
And I'll try and answer it in the context of what I've just said.
Then. Sure.
An example.
Sorry. It's more of a specific question.
Yeah, sure.
Two-part question, actually. What was the driving force of exploration into this lunar base? I mean, was it more of just a marketing strategy for Foster's? I mean, was it client-driven? It wasn't clear. And the second part, how many kilograms is the entire thing? How much is that? You said each kilogram costs like £200,000.
Yeah.
So I'm just wondering if it's allowed for you to say, I mean, the entire mechanism to go, how much did you... Mm-hmm. come to a calculation of how much it weighed?
How much did my building weigh, right? No, we didn't. We just knew that we didn't have to kind of bring all the regulator, all the kind of really the mass that you need to have to create that that shielding. We didn't need to take that. So how the rest of the building weighs and the I actually don't know. This was actually quite a fast study as well that we did. And it was for the European Space Agency. This was actually, what they do is they have this tender process. They have a kind of procurement system where they kind of put out loads and loads of research. And most of them, when I read these kind of briefs, I actually have no idea what they are. They're kind of totally, I can't understand. There's some mechanical thing for a screw somewhere in a satellite that they want somebody to research something, right? And this was one of those. So they, I get these emails every day, like a few, of new pieces of research that ESA really tenders out. And then as a company or consortium, you kind of go and for that job. So this was, in a way, a client with a piece of research that wanted to get done. So yeah, so it was completely client-driven.
Right. Well, thank you. Thank you guys for coming. We're going to take a break for lunch, and we'll come back for session two.
Thank you.